What does discovery mean when talking about video games, and why is it important? Well, discovery is essentially the player finding something, anything, on their own and not being told whether it's what to do, how to do it, where to go, or how to get there. Feeling like you've discovered something by yourself. And why is that important? Well, because we like to discover things. It's an inherently rewarding thing for us to do. And in game design, you're always looking to reward the player for their actions. Go here, do this, unlock reward. But genuine discovery is its own reward, so if you can incorporate that into your game's design, you're onto a winner. Which brings us onto Dark Souls. I've been thinking about the game a lot recently after watching an extra credits video called Exploration in Games: 4 Ways Players Discover Joy, which is a great video. I'll put a link in the description and I really recommend watching it. But in this video they discuss exploration in games, or as they prefer to call it, the joy of discovery, and the 4 different areas of game design that can incorporate this. So they basically say there's geographical discovery and also mechanical, content and narrative discovery. Now, Dark Souls was mentioned a few times in the video, just as a quick example of a game that has these different types of discovery, but the more I thought about it, the more I realised how important the nature of discovery was to Dark Souls. So much so that I think it might have been like the core design philosophy at the heart of the game. So using those 4 aspects they mentioned in the extra credits video as a template, let's take a look at the importance of discovery in Dark Souls. Geographical discovery is the joy of discovering and exploring new locations, and Dark Souls is pretty renowned for this. Firstly, there's the open world nature of the game. You're rarely told where you have to go, and in fact, from the very beginning at Firelink Shrine, there are 3 different areas you can choose to visit first, and this is rewarding because it gives the player a sense of freedom and control over their own journey that most other games lack. You get to choose where you go instead of being told. The game does, of course, try to discreetly encourage players to go to the undead burg first, but the only way it does this really is with the difficulty of enemies in the other areas. So the idea is that you might go to the cemetery and be like, right, this is really hard, I'm going to go somewhere else. But the key thing there is the game lets you make that decision. It doesn't make it for you by blocking the area off, so you feel like you're discovering the best path that works for you. Secondly, there's the interconnected design of the world in Dark Souls. Early on, when you enter the Undead Burg, you can see the bridge where you'll later encounter the dragon above you. If you look below, you can see the lower section of the Undead Burg, where you'll also find the entrance to the depths. Now, when you enter this area for the first time, you might not even pay that much attention to your vast surroundings, assuming it's all just background wallpaper. But when you get to these places and it clicks as to where you are in relation to where you've been, there's a joy in realising how the world and all these seemingly separate areas are actually connected. And when you start to notice that on a much larger scale, you discover how truly expansive the game world really is. This kind of discovery is also rewarded in the form of shortcuts that the player can unlock. When you open a shortcut that connects 2 areas, it's hugely satisfying, again because of the realisation of how the world is internally consistent, but also because often when you discover a shortcut, you'll have fought through a new area with difficult enemies, you might be low on Estus Flask, you might be carrying a load of souls, but you've fought on and that shortcut links you back to a safer area where you can rest at a bonfire. So there's both a sort of personal satisfaction and a tangible reward that comes from discovering your environment. Mechanical discovery can be when you discover something new about the mechanics that you didn't know before, or even just a moment when something about the game's mechanics click. And in Dark Souls that might be finally figuring out the invincibility frames during certain enemies' attack animations so that you can dodge through it, or getting the hang of the timing for parrying a certain enemy's attacks. It might be finding the right equipment build that works for you, one that balances attack and defence with stamina consumption and movement speed. In this regard, Dark Souls has a lot of variation. As someone who only really uses melee weapons, I still feel spoilt for choice. There's heavy weapons, light weapons, long, short and special weapons, all of which behave and feel very differently and will greatly impact the way you engage with enemies in combat. And that's without getting into magic and ranged attacks or how the 3 can be combined. In theory, you could tank your way through Dark Souls using heavy armour and a sledgehammer, and then do another playthrough with a ranged build and have 2 profoundly different experiences because of it. And the fun is in experimenting with these different builds and discovering ones that work for you. But more than that, Dark Souls challenges you to explore the mechanics and make new discoveries. It wants you to try different builds or alter your play strategy. If your character is strictly a melee or ranged build, certain enemies will have defences or attacks that you find yourself weak or ineffective against, so the game pushes you to consider changing your build to suit individual situations. the ghosts in New Londo ruins or the skeletons in the catacombs being susceptible to cursed weapons and divine weapons respectively are examples of this. But I think the best example, which I only recently learnt about when watching the fantastic Dark Souls commentary by Matthewmatosis, which you should definitely check out, I'll put a link in the description, is during the fight with Gravelord Nito, where he discusses how if you run around the arena, you activate loads of additional enemies and put yourself at risk to attacks. What you should do is stand your ground, wait for him to come to you, and keep close to him at all times. The game challenges you to go against your instincts, against perhaps the very same tactics you've probably used in every boss battle before it, to run around and put distance between you and the enemy. So thanks to the wealth of options when it comes to weapons and armor builds and play strategies, exploring the game's mechanics is always rewarding. Content discovery is basically finding new stuff, and as you'd expect from an RPG, Dark Souls is full of that. But what makes it interesting is how it goes out of its way to either hide items from you in easy to miss nooks and crannies or behind illusionary walls, or it will specifically put them in places of danger which make them hard to get or have them dropped by an enemy after you've killed them. So it's either rewarding to have just found it at all, hiding somewhere, or it's rewarding because you've overcome an obstacle to reach it, and that's before you even have the actual reward of the item itself. And this is clever because not every item is going to be useful for every player, so they've made sure that there's an inherent satisfaction just in obtaining it in the first place, regardless of how useful it might be. The significance of this approach to content discovery is that there's always an engagement with discovering content. Items are rarely just lying around on the ground for you to pick up arbitrarily. Even when you do find a chest just sat there out in the open, the game has probably already subverted your expectations by having introduced mimics. So content discovery in Dark Souls is always engaging. Narrative discovery is perhaps the most widely discussed and praised aspect of discovery in Dark Souls. There's very, very little story given to the player, very few cutscenes or dialogue that they're forced to sit through. The vast majority of the game's story is left for the player to discover themselves by reading item descriptions and piecing together clues to form connections and theories, and by interacting with NPCs and exhausting their dialogue options at various different points throughout the game. Dark Souls is deliberately vague, and I think it's purposefully designed so that the more a player is prepared to put in, the more they're likely to get out of it. And so whatever they do get out of it is going to be rewarding because they'll feel like they've discovered it for themselves. Now, so far I've talked about all these different aspects individually, as if they're all exclusive from each other, but they're not, and it's how they all work together in unison where Dark Souls really starts to shine. So let's examine how geographical, mechanical, content and narrative discovery work together to great effect. The most simple, obvious example of this would be the relationship between geographical and content discovery. In the case of Dark Souls, it isn't just items that you can discover, it's actually entire locations, and when you discover a whole new area, it kind of by default comes packed with loads of content. An obvious example is the Great Hollow, which eventually leads to Ash Lake, two pretty sizable chunks of the game hidden behind an illusionary wall in Blighttown. And if you explore the environment surrounding Firelink Shrine, you'll discover the giant crow's nest, which takes you back to the asylum where you began, where new content awaits you. You can also find the strange doll here, which will then grant you access to the painted world of Ariamis in Anor Londo. So as you can see, content discovery can lead to geographical discovery and vice versa. But it gets even more interesting when you start to add mechanical discovery into that mix. There's various examples of how the mechanics of the game, equipping certain items or using your abilities, can influence or impact how you discover new locations and content. When you lower the water in New Londo Ruins, the boss in that area, the Four Kings, can't be accessed unless you've equipped the Covenant of Artorias ring, which allows you to enter the abyss without dying. You can't get through Lost Izalith without equipping the Orange Charred ring, which allows you to walk across lava, or without using a spell. Then of course there's rings such as the Ring of Fog, which makes you harder to detect, useful if you're exploring an area heavily populated with enemies, or the Rusted Iron Ring, which lets you move faster in deep water. You may at times want to remove your equipment altogether in order to lighten your movement speed so you can use your running jump to reach new areas and make new discoveries. And of course you also have narrative discovery all mixed up in there as well. Killing Guinevere, Princess of Sunlight, unlocks loads of new content, a new area with new items and a new boss. In terms of geography, it completely transforms the way the whole environment looks, and mechanically, you're more likely to be invaded by members of the Blade of the Darkmoon Covenant. But most significantly, it has major revelations in regards to the story, potentially providing you with a whole new insight. Let the atonement for thy felonies commence. Likewise, discovering and interacting with NPCs that have their own story arcs can have major implications on your playthrough, such as when Lautrec kills Anastasia and suddenly you're left without a bonfire in one of the most significant locations within the game. This is a game that not only lets you kill NPCs, but says maybe you should kill some of them before they kill someone else that has consequences for you.
It pains me to think of the trouble my failings have caused.
Now, some of this might sound pretty basic or not that significant, but remember, Dark Souls never tells you any of this. It leaves it up to you to find this stuff out by discovering content, exploring the geography, and experimenting with the mechanics. And these different aspects of the design work together to encourage you to do this. It will put you in situations out of your comfort zone where these things work together in an attempt to foster new discoveries. For example, the level design of an area like Sen's Fortress, with all its booby traps and ambushes, may push you to experiment with ranged attacks if you're a melee player. It might encourage you to favour agility if you're a heavy build. The Tomb of the Giants, on the other hand, plunges you into almost total darkness and greatly reduces the effectiveness of ranged players. However, the darkness will still mean that melee players might need to forsake their shield for a lantern. And lastly, there's one more aspect of game design that utilises discovery that isn't mentioned in the extra credits video, and that's the multiplayer, or in this case, the online connected nature of Dark Souls. Now, this might seem like a bit of a stretch because some of it could be seen as just adding to the pre-existing stuff I've talked about, but the online provides so many opportunities for players to make unique kinds of discoveries that wouldn't be possible if it weren't for the online aspect, that I feel it deserves to be discussed on its own. The world of Dark Souls isn't just inhabited by you. You're always aware of the other adventurers undergoing the same journey as yourself, and so you feel like part of a shared experience, and by participating in that shared experience, you can all discover things together. So for example, with the messages on the ground, you can help other players make all sorts of discoveries in a world that's full of optional and missable content. You might leave a message after discovering a hidden item or an illusionary wall, or send a message yourself that helped you find something, clues as to strategies in combat or how to approach a dangerous situation. So players are actively helping each other out by discovering things together, and I think From Software must have intended for this kind of shared discovery, or else they might not have risked making significant chunks of the game world hidden and entirely missable. By summoning other players to fight alongside you, you can discover new strategies during combat, new weapons or armor builds, or by engaging in PvP combat, you can put your skills to the test in a way that perhaps the AI can't. And so you discover something about yourself, like your own strengths and weaknesses, perhaps what types of attacks you're vulnerable to, or what your areas of weakness are that need to be improved. Then of course there's the online community outside of the game, where fans create and share content or formulate and discuss theories on the story and how it all fits together. Dark Souls is one of the most passionate and creative online communities out there, and I think that's by design. I think From Software very carefully, very cleverly cultivated that kind of reaction from their audience by making discovery such a key component of the Dark Souls experience. So there you go, that's the importance of discovery in Dark Souls. It really feels to me like From Software looked at the most fundamental aspects of game design and asked, how can we inject a bit of exploration and discovery in that? How can we make it more engaging and more rewarding on every level? And I think that emphasis on discovery might be the germ of an idea that everything in Dark Souls and obviously Demon's Souls grew out of. The difficulty, the environments, the ambiguous narrative. And in an industry where so many games now just hold your hand, are so scripted and automated, where the player barely gets to think for themselves, sometimes to the point where things feel like an elaborate, overwrought game of Simon Says, Dark Souls was a breath of fresh air, and I would love to see more developers take a leaf out of its book. And I hope that by boiling the game down to its essence and examining how it uses discovery in every aspect of its design, developers might actually find it a lot easier to draw influence from it without just ripping it off and making a Souls clone. Thanks for watching and for sticking it out to the end. I hope you've enjoyed the video. I normally do in-depth reviews of games, but I wanted to try something a bit different, so please let me know what you thought. I'd love to find out. I read every comment, and let me know if you'd like to see more videos like this, because I've got a few ideas. If you're new to my channel, feel free to check out my other videos and subscribe. Thanks again. Bye.